Hi, I'm John Malos. Welcome to this live edition of Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this day. It's a Wednesday morning today. We're talking politics here in the city of Fresno. A Fresno City Councilman is in the house. We're going to talk to him about what's coming up for tomorrow's council meeting and all of some of what problems lie ahead for the city of Fresno. You can call in 436-ME-TV, option 11. We've got an open phone line and we are waiting for your call. Back in a moment. All right, back here on the program on Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. Glad you're here. A couple of programming notes for tomorrow and Friday. All right, tomorrow we've got a couple of students from Buchanan High School. They're going to talk about that play that was apparently canceled by the Clovis Unified School District. We're trying to get a comment also from Kelly Avents. She is the spokesperson for the Clovis Unified School District, so we'll see if she will get back to us. But the two students will be in here to talk about some of their grievances and why that play was canceled. You know, that thing was publicized all over the Fresno Bee. It was on talk radio. It was on some of the news stations, so we'll get into the gritty details about what that play was all about. Apparently, it dates back to the 40s, and it's called No Exit. And so I hope you don't exit us from your television set here on this day, because it's a hot show today. We're talking politics. Hey, on Friday, Peter Nazaridian is going to be here. He's going to, I think, analyze for us why people lie. We all lie, I guess, to a certain extent, right? We all tell white lies, but I'm talking about lie after lie after lie. We might even highlight some of the comments made by Sean Spicer, the White House spokesperson. I don't know. We'll talk about that on Friday. In the meantime, you're watching us live on Comcast Channel 375, as usual. And I say this over and over again, if you don't have Comcast, not to worry, or if you're deciding to get rid of Comcast, 13.1 or 43.6 over the air broadcast with an antenna. Later in the day, believe it or not, like it or not, we broadcast this show two more times. 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 13.6 YouTube, 8 o'clock tonight on 4.6 Biz TV. And then after that, it's on YouTube for a long time. Anyway, the issue of slumlords right here in the city of Fresno is not going to be going away anytime soon. Now, you can be sure of that, but I will tell you this. The city of Fresno, the council, and the mayor are going to face this problem head-on here in the near future. Let's put up a picture up on the screen first, and I want to talk about this young man here. It all started back in the fall of 2015. Chris Henry, dubbed public enemy number one in Fresno, accused of being a slumlord. He was eventually fined some $200,000. Change it. Then last month, this man put on notice by the city, Kumar Sharma of Los Angeles, the owner of the Hotel California, also dubbed a possible slumlord. All right, roll the videotape. All 49 doors of the hotel were tagged by code enforcement. Tenants left scrambling and desperate to find a new place to stay. Now, keep in mind, this is not an apartment complex. This is a hotel meant for short stays, but people with no credit, prior evictions, unreliable income were all welcome for long-term stays. Hotel California described as a potential fire hazard. Appliances, portable heaters in the rooms could have forced a breaker overload. Some of the residents blaming the city and Lee Brand, the administration, for the sudden crackdown and leaving them hanging with no place to go. They say many of these problems, like drugs and crime, have persisted at this place for years. Some residents claim they can't afford to stay anywhere else based on their income.
A leaky pipe up there? Well, if you got a leaky pipe, you fix the pipe, then fix the ceilings.
Right.
You don't just let it go.
Yeah.
They were out here this morning, so obviously they didn't red tag it.
Yeah.
I've asked Oliver Baines to have them come out again this afternoon.
smoke it last.
Okay. If the city doesn't deem this place uninhabitable, we will have to do this piecemeal, one person at a time, as they're being evicted or as their rents come up for payment.
I've already been in the hospital now and out, and I was getting sick again. And he pulled the baseboard back, and it was all mold. But they did fix it, but it took them almost a week.
The other one person today is in a motel room, so she was evicted on Monday. So she, as of today, is in a motel for the next week until they can coordinate her services and get her housed.
She was evicted Monday?
She was evicted Monday. She was locked out.
Why?
She didn't have the full rent. She was $10 short, so he locked her out.
And our thanks to the Fresno Bee on that video. Live in our studio right now is City Councilman Steve Branda, who led the charge in early December, you might recall, on a proposed ordinance that would crack down on slumlords. He led the charge in early December to put off that vote, but that vote's coming up on February the 2nd. So they're going to revisit that, and we'll talk to Steve on the other side of the break here about what to do about slumlords and also about residents that don't pay their rent or don't take care of their place. All right. You're welcome to call in. The city councilman is here, district number 2436, MeTV, option 11. Back after this brief timeout.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Whirlpool appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Touch the new Whirlpool Ice Collection. It offers a modern style made to create an inspiring kitchen experience. Save big on this Whirlpool Black Ice or White Ice Kitchen. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise today.
When you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on Energy Star qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Back here on the program, 436, MeTV Option 11. Apparently, this has been a problem for a long time here in the city of Fresno. Talking about slumlords, we got a new mayor in the house, of course, Lee Brand, and he is a former property owner. He owned apartment complexes. He knows all about this issue. He knows the laws on how to deal with this kind of thing. And so Steve Brandau is here, City Councilman District 2. How are you?
Yeah, good. Thank you for having me on.
Well, thank you for coming in. I appreciate you taking the time and how busy you are. You led the charge in early December to put off a vote on a proposed ordinance to crack down on slumlords. Why?
Well, the administration, at that time, it was the Swearengen administration. Okay. They weren't ready for game time. So they were trying to provide council what we call red line additions of the policy right up to the last minute. In other words, they didn't have all their ducks in a row. And that happens, so I'm not blaming them, but they didn't have all their ducks in a row. We were very unclear what we were gonna be asked to vote on that day. We're supposed to have that product to us ahead of time so we know what's going on. We didn't have it. They weren't ready for prime time, so I just said, I simply suggest we continue this item to February. Well, I suggested we continue the item. Councilman Brand walked in and asked me if we could do it for a specific day, the first week of February. So we'll be hearing this item February 2nd.
What will you do about it? What will the council do about it? What will the mayor do about it? Will you all be on board?
Yeah, that remains to be seen. Councilman Olivier and I had co-sponsored an anti-slumlord unit of code enforcement that we called Asset, right? It's built kind of a law enforcement go get them aspect of slum housing. So we target
it includes inspections.
Yeah. Okay? But it targets the bad guys. The mechanism is if somebody triggers, like the video you just showed, you could have somebody complain. We created an ombudsman position. Somebody could complain. And then this asset unit would go in and see if there's a true slum housing problem.
How soon would they get there?
Immediately.
After the call.
Yeah, the call's built to be answered within 24 hours. So it is a strong kind of a law enforcement approach to cracking down on the bad guys. What we're going to hear about in the first week of February has some of that element, but it's also the other side of it, which the slum housing activists are excited about, which is universal inspections, a registry of every property in town, a lot of these very progressive ideas, and that's what they believe. They call it a proactive approach to getting slum housing. But I'll tell you, I watched the video as you were showing it on the station here just a moment ago, and John, there's a lot of propaganda going on in this deal, right? And one of my jobs is to filter through the propaganda and get down to brass tacks.
Okay, talk about the propaganda, because the news reports that I read and heard about, and I've done a lot of research, just reading a lot of stuff. Apparently, the Hotel California had no heat, had mold, cockroaches, mice, cracks in the walls, leaky faucets, missing shower heads, no window screens, no smoke detectors. Are you kidding me? Wow. I don't know if all that's true. I'm just reporting what I've read.
Mm-hmm. Well, I went out there, so I read a lot of the same stuff, and I read.
And
out
is it
there.
True?
I didn't see a lot of that. You know, there's some of that going on. So okay. I guess if you have, I can't remember, was it 49 units? If you have 49 units, you're going to see.
That are red tagged.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, everybody gets. Yeah, they red tag it because the government is reacting to the outcry from the Fresno Bee, the activist community, Elaine. Robles that was shown right there
on the video.
I've been out in the units. Yeah. They had an electrical. They have a true problem. They have to upgrade their electrical panels. Right. I didn't. By the way, I didn't see any cockroaches. John, I'm just
mice?
Simply.
You see any mice?
I didn't see any mice. Are you kidding me?
All right.
So here's the deal.
Mold
I saw
is a different
units,
thing.
John, that I would spend the night in. That's what I saw. Okay. Now, not all of them. Some of them were trash. Some of them are trash because of the tenants. Okay.
Right.
My question is. Why are the tenants there? I mean, why? Why? What's the problem? This guy's creating a service. The people use it. Now, when we went in there and red tagged all these units and kicked them out, we found housing for all these folks. All
everybody these folks. Got housing.
Yeah. Yeah. Everybody
city,
got housing.
The city looked for housing and
the
found
city
it for
partnered
them.
With a group of Continuum of Care, the Housing Authority, a lot of good people, just regular people came in and said, we can find places for all these people. They bent over backwards for all of those families. But, John, the bigger problem is we have lots of hotels just like that one. Are we going to just make this one guy the bad guy, or are we going to go after all those others? Now, I suggest that if we start going after this problem, we're going to end up with people out on the streets, okay?
But you can't.
And you and I are going to feel...
But you can't have a fire hazard. You can't. And these hotels or motels or whatever that you want to call them... are not meant for long-term stays. You can't, they don't have the electrical system to put in a portable heater, a refrigerator. It's a fire hazard, Steve.
Yeah, there's some truth to that. Now, but we didn't give that guy the chance to address that problem. We wanted to go in and create another big headline grabbing, this is what we're doing to fix the problem. My guess is we're gonna hit this one guy real hard. The community's gonna go back to sleep. And the problem's going to continue within
let's hope it doesn't
yards
continue.
Of this property.
I mean, not to single him out, but use him perhaps as an example that these other slumlords, or if you want to call him a slumlord, I don't know, that you can't do this. And the residents have to keep up their property, the property that they live in, whether it's a hotel or an apartment. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Steve, let me commend you on... doing something for everyone, city plus the people, but I must say, you know, if you're renting an apartment, whatever, city should have done something years ago by sending inspectors, like let's say every month, you know, it's a city issue, and go around and ask the people what the problem is and this and that. Like you say, maybe they're not cockroaches, but the mold and all that, the slum lords could have taken care of that. It should be penalized because you know what? People are living in units, and maybe this, for the reason that they don't pay rent is, why should I pay rent if I have mold and I have this and that? It also takes the renters, you know, a place to clean up. So. It's not only the renters, but also the city to you know, send some inspectors over. That's like renting a house. A landlord has a right to go and check their units, I mean, their homes, that they rent it. And I think the city has every right to send out an inspector. What do you think, Steve?
Well, I'd like to know. Is the caller still on?
Where do we get
the money for all of this? We have 90,000 or more units, apartments or condos or motel rooms in the city of Fresno. 90,000, that's a lot of inspectors. That's a lot of money. And
start one by one, I guess. Well, one by one.
You know what, John? Here's the answer to this guy. A lot of people don't want to pay for all of that stuff. A lot of people think, you know, not all of these units are bad. Let's the good units, nobody needs to inspect those. So we're going to find out on February 2nd. Now, there, to your caller, this is what I pledged to him. I created a program of code enforcement that goes after the bad people. When we hear about mold, we created an ombudsman.
Right.
When they get a phone call, there's mold in my unit. Within 24 hours, we check it out. We find out if it's truly a problem. If it is, there's a group in place, a part of code enforcement called Asset, that can go out there and address the bad. So I'm doing something. That's an aggressive approach. But I'm not willing to just throw a broad net upon every rental unit in the city of Fresno and treat them all like criminals and slumlords.
Okay,
it's not my thing.
Got to take a break. But you are on February the 2nd going to propose or vote on an anti-slumlord enforcement team that includes an ombudsman and something called, what'd you call it, the Asset?
Yeah, Asset is the anti-slum enforcement team.
Okay.
That's the acronym. So Lee Brand, the new mayor, is going to propose something, an ordinance, okay?
Right.
I haven't seen it yet. I believe I'm going to see it later today, okay? He's going to propose something. Parts of that will include what Clint Olivier and I had put forward right before Christmas. So a way to...
But it's an aggressive approach.
Mine is an aggressive approach.
Targeting
the other one is like throwing cotton balls at a fireplace.
I understand.
Okay? So mine is an aggressive approach. It's Asset.
Right.
Now this other stuff about, hey, why don't we grab inspectors? Nobody's going to tell us how to pay for them. Grab inspectors and go out here and inspect the whole city of Fresno. That's a very progressive approach. Good luck.
But your aggressive approach targets landlords, am I right?
Yeah, slumlords.
Slumlords.
Slumlords. The other stuff targets everybody.
Okay.
Yeah.
The other stuff meaning?
What the activists would like to do, John, is really simple. They want a registry of every rental property in Fresno.
You're not in favor of that.
No. Uh-uh. No, I'm not. Uh-uh. Do they? And they might want to knock on your door. John, I want to come in and inspect your place. How do you feel about that?
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Caller, go ahead.
Yeah, good morning, John and Steve. I don't know if this was talked about, but I guess a lot of people ask this question. How did this guy ever get a permit in the first place? First question, that was the first one. Second one, when they did give him the permit, evidently they did, is most of it his fault or the city's fault? I mean, this is, you could go either way on this one or both. Okay, that's the questions for the day for me. And
those are
you,
good
Steve,
questions.
For showing up.
Yeah,
okay.
Thank you.
So how do you get the permit?
Yeah, those are very good questions. So
this guy bought the
motel about a year ago, right? And he wanted to do some upgrades,
but he
immediately started. Yeah, there he is right there. Immediately, you know, he continued renting out the units, and so he had a business game plan. Now, the city of Fresno, when somebody got evicted, one person was getting evicted. She didn't like getting evicted, so she started complaining. Her complaints fell on the ears of activists. Activists showed up and whipped up a lot of attention on this deal, right?
That's Kumar Sharma, by the way, of L.A. County. Doesn't live here. Go ahead. Go ahead,
Steve. Whoop-de-doo. A lot of people that own property in Fresno don't live here. So Kumar, this guy, he's just like a lot of people in the city of Fresno. He took over a motel, continued running it. He probably didn't even know that he had all of the, some of these code enforcement issues. When they came out, they saw that these issues were present, and they said, this creates a hazard. We're going to have to boot everybody out of here. I'm fine. They're doing a lot of work out there. This guy's out there every day fixing that place up. Now, to go back to your caller's...
Hang on, caller. I'll get to you in a moment.
To go back to your caller's other question is...
Whose
fault is it, right?
City?
Yeah.
Is it his?
This guy bought a property, didn't even know. I believe that some of the responsibility falls on the city of Fresno for not knowing what's going on or turning up a blind eye to what's going on. But it's not just this one property. Okay?
You think the city turned a blind eye or the city just didn't know about it? Not this particular...
My guess is I actually believe the city didn't know about it. That's what I want to believe, that the city didn't know about it. That's
about this overall problem.
About the... Yeah.
The extent of the problem.
About motels being part of the problem.
Right.
Now, we've known that there is a slum problem for some time. And you'd have to be a blind person not to see that as you drive through Fresno.
I'm specifically talking about these motels that are turned into apartments. The city, you think, didn't kind of realize that this was going on, these long-term stays?
I think they probably didn't realize some of the code issues.
Like the
lack of proper electrical panels that were installed at this particular complex or motel. So once they got once it got triggered, they saw there was a problem there. I don't mind them reacting, John. That's not my complaint. I don't want to see them overreact, paint one guy out to be the devil, let everybody else off scot-free, fool the public into thinking something's been done. You help 26 people, and there's thousands over here, same conditions, you didn't do anything about.
That's why you're creating asset. Okay, or hope to, anyway, on February 2nd. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air with Steve Brandow.
My asking is, I used to own 8 different properties, and I used to rent out and stuff like that, but I got away from that because, to me, it seems like I was renting to people. I would fix up the place, I would do everything they needed, but they would just trash the place. They would trash them, and then act like they didn't care. And if I didn't fix it up right away, they're calling the city, they're calling code inspection, and I finally got out of the whole thing because, not to be sound in a mean way, but my own daughter lives kind of like that. I've gone to where she lives, and I go, mija, that's my daughter in Spanish, what are you doing? She goes, I go, you're trashing this place. And she goes, I'll just go get another place, and I'll just move somewhere else and get another place. And then they're like, no, they move from place to place to place, trashing the places. And, it's, as a landlord, it's hard to catch up. And then if you don't rent the place right away or try to get it at least decent and then move, and you're losing money. So it got to the point where I couldn't catch up anymore. So I just sold everything and got out of the whole business. But what is the city doing about these people that live like that? They just go around trashing place to place to place, and because the city's going to give them a new place to live. They don't care. So, is the city going to hold them people accountable? I don't want them in the street. That's the worst thing that can happen. But there are, let's not joke anybody, there are people like that out there. They just don't care, and county will take care of them. The city of Fresno will take care of them. Poverello will take care of them, which is great. That's great. That's great for them. But what about people that are just trying to make a living, trying to, do something and try to help people? I own my properties in low-income areas, and trying to help people. And they would just trash the place. And I was like, I did have good renters. But, I gave up the whole thing. The good ones had to go and the bad ones left. And so I just got a whole thing. That's my question. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm so glad, John, that caller called, because he illustrates another side of the conversation that gets left behind. A lot of these landlords, you can't believe the stuff they put up with, okay? So I do realize there are slum lords, okay? I'm willing to go after them. But we have another problem, and this caller lived through it himself, where we have tenants that just trash the place. And once it gets to the level where it's too big of a problem for them, they just exit stage left, leave the landlord with this huge, massive, expensive problem. They go to another place. And if you burn enough landlords, John, you know where you end up? You end up at that motel that we were just... When you burn enough landlords that you can't fill out an application, the guy that charges you $40 a day for the motel, he's there for you.
Because they check references.
Yeah, right.
They do check references. And so, this California hotel, apparently they accepted just about anybody, even if you had... so much on your record in terms of prior evictions, not paying your rent, whatever the case may be, and that was part of the problem. 436-ME-TV, option 11, if you want to call in and weigh in with Steve Brandow. Back in a moment.
When you're looking for Whirlpool innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on ENERGY STAR qualified Whirlpool appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
The Justice Network is here. If you haven't tuned in, you're missing a great lineup of gripping stories of real crime, plus an unprecedented effort by viewers like you to play an active role in making your community safer. You can help support law enforcement by providing information that may lead to the apprehension of dangerous criminals or find a missing child. Great shows and your chance to fight crime, only on the Justice Network.
Talking about the housing problem here in the city of Fresno, slumlords to be exact, and Steve Brandow is here. I want to run through some of the photos of Somerset Village that took place more than a year ago, back in October, I believe, or November of 2015. This was the Chris Henry deal. And so, Steve, Chris Henry got his day in court, I guess, $200,000 fine. These are some of the tenants or residents that had to move out. One resident actually died. Don't know if it was related to having no heat, no hot water, whatever the case may be. That was an awful situation. But I do have an email question here. Are the housing units being tabbed approved Section 8 dwellings? I don't know the answer to that.
What is that question again?
Yeah.
Are the housing units being tabbed approved Section 8? I really don't know how to answer that. I do know one thing, that if a unit's been inspected for Section 8 purposes, that's good enough for it to be considered a city inspection as well.
All right.
So that's kind of interesting, but the whole question I don't know how to answer.
Yeah, the Section 8 is kind of out of my realm here. I'd have to do more
homework. It's a federal program, right.
It really is. Yeah, it is a federal program. Will owners of targeted housing units be fully responsible for upgrades? Another email question.
Yeah, that's the big question is what types of upgrades. So if we go in and inspect a unit, because it's got a mold problem, when we're in there and there's holes in the carpet, is that a health and safety? If there's a hole in the wall, if the tenant got drunk and punched a hole in the wall, is the owner responsible for that hole in the wall? So there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of good questions.
In other words, how did that hole in the wall get there?
Yeah, and is that hole, if the hole exposes wiring, I think that's a health and safety issue, right?
Right,
but
and
if
that's
it
not
doesn't,
a tenant problem, that's a landlord problem.
Yeah.
And so is infestation. If you have cockroaches, if you have mice, if you have rats,
yeah,
that's a landlord issue.
That's debatable, John. So a landlord, okay. What if a landlord delivers a place to a tenant, it's clean, no cockroaches, no mice?
And then they come
a year later, they're there. Is that a landlord problem, or is it
prove how they got there? Yeah. Yeah,
is it the three-week-old pizza in the bathtub? You know. So.
Okay. Another email question: can the unit's electrical systems be upgraded while the tenants remain on the premises?
You know, I bet that happens all the time, unless you want to make a show of something. So, if you want to make a show of something, you boot everybody out, red tag the facility, and fix all of the units. And we're going to see what happens, because this guy is not going away. He's doing the stuff that we're asking him to do. So it'll be very interesting.
All right. Tomorrow's city council meeting, as I change topics here, will focus on a specific issue. The makeup of the city council is a little bit different now. You got Gary Bredefeld on there, Luis Chavez on there. And the council now, apparently, and you're included in this, ready to possibly, I don't say for sure, to cancel a contract worth about $175,000 with outside consultants. These consultants hired by the previous administration or previous council to study citywide parks. The consultants, by the way, are Burt's Reza Strategy and Creative, subcontractors Catalano and Fenske, Fresno Building Healthy Communities. And so this is worth about $175,000. Apparently, they've already been paid about $15,000. Why is this an issue?
You know, it was a vote that happened towards the end of last year. A lot of the folks that you just mentioned, They'd done a lot of work previously for, or they'd worked and are friends of the mayor, former mayor, Ashley Swearingen. And so, you know, this barely passed last time. And now
4-3 it passed last
time.
Yeah,
4-3, which is a barely pass. And I think now with
Hang
some
on,
new
caller.
Council members, they want to take another look at this. That's what I'm hearing. Now, I don't have a lot of energy behind this. I'll probably vote the same way I did last time.
Yeah, you got, hang on, caller. From my count, I got Gary Bredefeld, Esmeralda Soria, Clint Olivier, and yourself against paying this money to consultants. Is it a waste of money? Because Gary Bredefeld told the Fresno Bee, people are sick and tired of spending money on consultants that the city doesn't need.
So there's overlap with this consulting project. There's overlap with another consultant that also does public outreach. That other consultant is in charge, and it's more like $500,000 for what we call our Parks Master Plan.
Right.
Okay. So within that Parks Master Plan, they're doing public outreach, but we wanted to, for some reason, Mayor Swearingen felt like we needed an extra consultant to do more of the same work.
Or consultants.
Yeah.
For $175,000.
So, and so.
But that money could be better used somewhere else, you think?
Well, I do. I would agree with Gary Bredefeld that you just quoted, our new council member.
It's a waste of money.
Yeah, and there's a redundancy, John, and we don't have the money for redundancies.
Yeah, and I see 4 votes here to scrap this thing.
Seems like it, yeah.
Does that seem apparent to
you?
Yeah,
I don't get to count to 4 because of the Brown Act. I can only talk to 2 other people.
No, I understand, but Bredefeld has spoken out against it. Soria has, Olivier has, and so have you. So that's 4 to me.
Yeah, right.
4-3. So there's Clint Olivier right there. Caller, go ahead. You're on the line with Steve Brandow.
Yeah, John, just a quick question. When a property owner sells his property and another gentleman buys it, or a corporation, don't they have a right to go through like a walkthrough to make sure everything's in order? And if not, why buy it if it's not in order to where you can rent them? Thanks, John.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, there's a lot of good technical questions inside of that question. So the guy bought the property. We now know that it was not up to code. He didn't know that. He bought a functioning property, right? Not something that needed to be rehabbed. He bought a property that was already in doing business, and he just assumed, probably his own fault, and now it's going to cost him a lot of money, that the property was fine. And the city of Fresno probably didn't know better either. So unfortunately for this guy, but the story should be okay. As long as he fixes his property and fixes electrical problem, I hope the city of Fresno will deal square and evenly with him and fair with him and let him continue business. But
yeah, I'm just excited about this new code enforcement team that could possibly pass here and get passed through on February the 2nd, where you can just pick up the phone and within 24 hours you could have somebody at your apartment.
Yeah, it actually passed, John. So to be honest with you, we already voted, it passed, but it was not funded.
You're waiting for the funds.
The funding to fund
and
the
Lee
bodies.
Brand, yeah. Lee Brand, doesn't he have to sign off on it? It's already been, yeah.
Yeah, Lee Brand voted for it, yeah.
Yeah.
It was passed when he was a council member.
Okay.
So it's already been passed. We just need to fund it.
Here's another thing that could be facing the Fresno City Council. Maybe you've already faced it or talked about it, not sure, but the new home construction right here in the city of Fresno. Mm-hmm. There is going to be a water connection fee of $6,500. Right now, the builders, I guess, are going to have to pay for it. But there is some debate. Should the builder pay for it? Should the new buyer pay for it? $6,500 is a big chunk of change for anybody. I don't know the call. I'm going to put them on hold, let you answer that question. Hang on, caller. Get to you in a moment. Is that a big issue?
It's because a huge issue.
That could affect what? The housing market?
Yeah, the housing market. And here's what really happens, John, and you know this. When they get charged those extra bill, that extra $6,500, do they just eat it for every house? No, they pass it on.
Wait, you're talking about the owner.
The developer.
The developer.
Yeah, the developer builds 100 houses.
And he's got to pay for that connection.
$6,500 per house, and he passes it on to the new owner. Never tells them, builds it into the price. Instead of $230,000, it's $236.5, right? And
right.
Gets passed on. Now, what does that do? It skews the market, and people think, you know, these things are getting too expensive.
And the buyer doesn't even realize it.
Right, right. So the truth is, now, I answer the, so that's the impact. It gets passed on to the consumer. The developer's not going to eat that price. It gets passed on to the consumer. Housing goes up. People can't afford housing. All of a sudden, the state of California has this crisis, a housing crisis in the state of California, right? Because we build so many costs and taxes and fees into the price of our housing, it's too expensive for people to afford.
Where do you stand on this issue? Who should pay for that?
Well, the truth is there's good news on this issue, on this particular issue. As of yesterday, my understanding, having talked with the new chief of staff to the mayor, is a guy named Tim Orrin.
Yeah, I know Tim. Yeah,
you know Tim. So I spoke with Tim. He said they re-looked at this. They found out the sticker price is not going to be that high. Now, I don't know what it's going to be, but it's not going to be $65. I think it's going to be more like $4,000 or something like that. Now, that's still...
How was that determined? Research?
Yeah, research. So they go back in and they determine, you know, what do we need this for? You know, what do we need this increase of fees for? And then they determine, okay, here's the sticker price of what we need. And they realized, you know, we were trying to fund too much. So we don't need $6,500 per house. So I'm hoping that everybody ends up happy.
Who should pay for it, in your opinion?
Well, it's always the developer, the builder,
That pays for these types, not the owner, or the prospective buyer.
Hypothetically, again, it's the builder, the person who builds it, but they most normally pass that on to the new home buyer, which drives the price up, and all of a sudden you have a housing crisis because people can't afford housing.
But you can't stop the developer from implementing that into or injecting that into the price.
No.
Can you? It's against the law to try to do that.
Yeah, right. So
you can't stop it.
Can't stop it.
If a developer wants to build a piece of property, wants to sell it to Steve Brandow, and now you got that water hookup fee, and he's going to say, okay, I'm going to charge this guy $3,400 more or $4,000 more, whatever the cost may be, he won't even know it.
Right.
Move on to the next one.
So to your watchers, to your viewers, I would say this, you know, beware that $6,500 is not going to be paid by the big developer. It's going to be paid by you. Okay.
Right.
So if you want to pay that additional $6,500, you know.
And just to confirm, the city can't do anything about it.
Well, what we do, our role is to make sure, should it be $6,500 or maybe it's supposed to be $4,000 or $3,200? There's a balance in there that's valid. We have to charge for what we provide. Okay.
Right.
So we have to find that balance.
Caller, you've been patient. Go ahead. You're on with Steve Brandow.
I think Mr. Brandow sounds like every other councilman that's been there in the past 50 years, and that is that every time they make an ordinance that says you have to, you know, we're going to charge the fee to the developer to install whatever water or whatever, they go back next year, and they say, well, we'll actually put this fee, we'll give them a waiver for like 5 years or whatever, and then we'll pass on the problem to the general taxpayers of the city of Fresno. So, you know, Mr. Brandow is a wonderful. He'll be an excellent councilman if he stays on long enough. And so, but in terms of the renters thing, I guess when Mr. Brandow was saying how you have buyers that don't live in Fresno, but they buy land here, they buy apartments here, and they don't know that they're not up to code. And so, you know, Mr. Brandow makes it sound like these people, because they don't know the property they're buying is not up to code, that they're not to blame. So I guess I would like to ask Mr. Brandow, is there going to be an ordinance that requires a purchaser of property to have that land and the buildings on it inspected by the city prior to the purchase, so that when a landowner or a prospective owner outside of the Fresno will know exactly what they're getting? So that an ordinance that says you can't sell this land or these apartments until they're up to code. That's a question I would like to ask.
You know, that's a great question.
That is a very good question, right? This caller's putting me in the hot seat. So here's to answer the caller the most direct that I can, is the policy is going to come from the mayor. So Mayor Brand really needs to get his message, the caller's message, because it's the mayor that puts the policy out on the table, and then council responds to that, okay?
It can work the other way around. Yeah.
But on this issue, it's coming from the mayor's office. They're the one that are constantly out asking questions. They're going to put together a policy, and I don't know right now if that policy includes an inspection at the turnover of the sale of a property, right? Which I think is what they were asking.
Yeah.
If the property's up for sale, the city should come in and inspect the property before the new owner takes over. So I don't know if that's going to be included, but I'd be interested if it is.
All right, got to take a quick break here. We're going to come right back with Steve Brandow, city councilman in District Number 2. If you don't know what that is, that's out there in Northwest Fresno. 436-ME-TV, option 11. Please call in if you have a question for Steve. Back in a moment.
It's Sully and Russ on the Big Biz Show.
It's your biz.
And maybe they'll start listening to Baldwin McCullough.
Now, before you make any money moves, check in with the Brain Trust.
And you are starting your week off right. Biz TV is now on KDHF Channel 4.6.
Frigidaire. It means the first electric refrigerator. The first compact electric range. Now, there's the Frigidaire Gallery Range with Symmetry Double Ovens. It's designed to cook multiple dishes at multiple temperatures, so you can prepare the entire meal at the same time. Frigidaire, over 90 years of legendary innovation.
See the full line of Frigidaire appliances at Ventura TV Electronics and Appliances.
I want to get to another quick issue here, and then we'll go to some of the topics we talked about yesterday, and that is roll the videotape on marijuana plants. Marijuana legal in California. However, what about commercial sales? The city of Selma is saying, okay, it's legal. You can smoke it. No problem. You can go out and light up a joint right in front of City Hall or right in front of the police department. We cannot arrest you. However, we can stop you from commercially selling this product. Selma did it. Will Fresno do it? Are you in favor of stopping it? Commercial sales.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So Selma is the town I grew up in. So I see what they're doing, and that's interesting. And I'll probably call down to the mayor of Selma and talk to them how they got through that process. So what I'm going to do is I believe it's my understanding, John, that we're going to have a workshop soon about the new marijuana law in the impact of the city of Fresno. Now, we are a charter city, which means we have some protections that we can call the shots that Sacramento just can't force us to do something. So we'll have some options open to us, and some of them probably like Selma did. So I think what I need to do is wait until that workshop, listen to all the information, and make a decision as, you know, what do I believe fits our community. Now, on this issue, I do hear from both sides. I hear from people that say, Steve, Sacramento, the state of Fresno voted, or excuse me, the state of California voted on it. We need to allow it, let it just go. And then I hear from law enforcement types that say, you better be very sure and do it step by step. So I'm going to be paying attention.
So you're not sure how you would vote?
I'm not
on
sure.
This.
No, in the past,
I've got to research it.
Yeah. In the past, historically, my votes in the past on marijuana have been no, I don't think we're ready to sell it in the streets of Fresno.
All right, another quick issue. Let's roll the videotape, I guess, on Dylan Noble. And we can do the body cam video. And I want to ask you about this because this is a hot topic, has been for quite some time here in the city of Fresno. We're not going to show this thing in its entirety, believe me, Steve. So don't worry about that. But I want to ask you about Jerry Dyer. A lot of heat on him, lawsuits coming his way, coming the city's way. You've got at least two now. You're going to have more lawsuits coming from that Northeast water issue, the discolored water issue, all these lawsuits. Are you concerned about the trust between the general public and the Fresno Police Department?
You know, if I was going to say that I have no concern, I don't think that's my response. I think I'm concerned somewhat. Now, some of the things that I'm concerned about, John, are, you know, is there a valid problem, or are there people that want to create a problem, right? Now, that's not popular for council members to come on TV and say that, but I'm telling you, there's people who would prefer there to be a problem because their little agenda and their little national message feeds on problems, right? And so they even tried to make this Dylan Noble shooting about a problem. Unfortunately,
do you have a problem with this shooting at all?
No, not in the sense that the police are out of control. I'm going to sit back and listen to the experts determine whether that fourth shot or that third and fourth shot was excessive. I don't know the answer to that.
Even that's Jerry outside. Dyer had some questions about the last
right.
shot.
Yes, he did. Right. Now, but to go back to your question is, do we have a problem between the citizens of Fresno and the police force? I don't see it, but
is
I'm not unconcerned.
Issue? Is there a trust issue after the Dylan Noble shooting, specifically after this?
You know, you'd have to ask somebody
it's,
else.
It's I, hard, it's my hard trust to gauge.
My trust is still right there. I trust our police department. Now, right. others don't share my opinion, okay?
Right.
And sometimes it's a matter of getting all of the facts in front of you and really sitting down and walking through this. I mean, this is two Hispanic American officers that shot a Caucasian dude, okay?
I understand.
Right? So... Yeah.
And I'm not asking you anything that I haven't asked Jerry Dyer. Jerry Dyer has come on this program and been very blunt and honest with us about how he feels about the Noble shooting. Very open to talk about it. He took calls. We know how he feels about it, but we better get out of this video here now before it goes any further.
Yeah, I don't think we have a problem like others do, and even including some of my colleagues on council believe there's a problem.
And I'm not anti-police. We need the police to protect us and our city. There are a lot of gangs here, a lot of violence, a lot of drugs. Whether you see it or not, whether you believe it or not, it's there. We do need our police department, no question about it. Hang on, caller. But I'm just wondering out there, you know, with the lawsuits coming the city's way, with so many protests, Black Lives Matter, and so forth, is there a trust issue? And I don't know the answer to that, and that's why I thought I'd ask you.
For some,
maybe
there
you
is.
Maybe you have a better gauge than I do. I don't know.
For me, I don't have a trust issue, but I know there are members of our, there are citizens that do, and there are other council members that do.
Right.
So I guess that's the best way to answer it. It's kind of mixed across the board depending on who you're talking to. I believe our police force, for trying to work in a city with the needs and the problems that the city of Fresno has, I think they do an outstanding job.
And you're behind Jerry Dyer 100%? 100%. Okay. Caller, you're on the air with Steve Brandow.
Yeah. Let me say one thing. I think what's happened, it's been... media issue. They make it more bigger than it is, and I'm not saying it's not. And I leave it up to the Lord to take care of that problem. I think it's the officer who did the last shot, and that was an issue between him and who drew or whatever. But, you know, you can look at it and say, okay, this is what happened. But I don't blame everything on Jerry. He can't be at every place, and I'm glad that the mayor got an extension for Jerry for two more years. I think he's done a great job with understaffed, okay? But you can't blame it all on the chief. And I hope the council, after the 2 years, gets someone really that can do the job better than Jerry, because I think he's done an outstanding job. If I was a mayor in a small town, man, I'd hire him and pay him three times what they give.
All right,
I'd give him.
Thank you.
But you know, the issue is too, the understaffed, and they're supposed to get some more officers on the streets.
Kind of short on time, so thank you. We get the gist of it. Okay, thanks, Steve.
Yeah, I totally agree with this caller. I think that Chief Dyer's doing a fantastic job. I also think that some of this distrust of law enforcement comes from the media constantly making a story out of that, right? And so that's what that's the society we live in.
All right, move on to another topic. Put up the picture of Jake Soberall. He is the young entrepreneur here in the city of Fresno, the co-founder and co-owner of Bitwise. Bitwise is really like a building, okay? He's like the landlord, and he calls all the, he's got this place open for any kind of tech company who wants to come in and rent space, and they run their businesses out of there. Well, he just announced that he's going to open up a couple of more buildings, go from like 30,000 square feet to, 300,000? A roll of videotape on the Bitwise slideshow. We can show the other buildings, too, if you want, Carrie. And so is this good for Fresno? And is this the new Silicon Valley? And will is this viable for downtown Fresno?
It's fantastic for Fresno.
Hang on, caller.
It's fantastic for Fresno, especially being located in downtown Fresno. It's great to see jobs that pull people down there that aren't government jobs, right? So Jake's doing a great job. He's more than the landlord. He's the CEO. He's the business leader. And he rents to a lot of up and upstarts where we're going to slowly but surely build a competitor to Silicon Valley right here in Fresno.
You think so?
Yeah. And you know what, John? What's really good about that is we have a lot of folks that graduate our high schools. They go to Fresno State. They go to Fresno City. They go to Pacific. And there's not a lot of tech jobs for them.
They go to
and
Silicon
so
Valley.
So then they move out of our valley,
yeah,
right? And this will at least grab some of them and say, hey, stay in the city of Fresno, raise your family in the city of Fresno. So I think it's fantastic.
Right, it's amazing. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air with Steve Brandow.
Yeah, this is Paul Conant. I just want to say, Steve, thank you so much for what you do for Fresno. You're thorough, you're understanding, and you're open-minded to everything. And you're just an asset to our Fresno. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul.
All right. Thank you very much. I do want to roll the videotape on the Fulton Street construction. This is recent video that we just shot the other day. It's called Fulton Construction. All right. Fulton Street is moving right along. Okay. We had Aaron Blair here yesterday talking about downtown Fresno. And things are happening there. You know, you just talked about Bitwise. Fulton Street is going to open up. But... and all these other young millennials that are living in downtown Fresno, everything is occupied. The Assemi projects are occupied with all these young single people that are working in downtown Fresno. But after hours, there's nothing to do in downtown Fresno. Restaurants, movie theaters, there's no entertainment. You got to go to the Tower District. You got to go to River Park. You've got to go somewhere else to get it. Is that a liability not to have that?
It's been a liability, but the video you're rolling is showing that the north end of Fulton, what was previously Fulton Mall, is about to be open and become Fulton Street, right? On the north. And then as soon as they finish the north, they're going to the south end and they'll meet in the middle. Eventually, that whole previously a pedestrian mall is going to be a street with traffic on it. John, when we took the vote to change that from a mall to a street, here is the result. We saw over $100 million of private investment come in and start buying up those properties. Now, why are they buying up those properties? Because they want to put in the restaurants, the bars, the clubs, the after-hour stuff that you're just requesting. And so I agree with you. It's not there right now. But when you see things like the like Fulton Street start to open again, that's a signal. Eventually, it'll come down there. Now, I'm not a guy, John, that says it's going to happen overnight. It's going to be like Shangri-La. But it'll take some time, but this is a good step that we're seeing.
We saw so many businesses close, according to Aaron Blair downtown, and he knows the numbers. He's got the figures. We went over the numbers yesterday. No need to go over them again. There were many businesses that closed, but then many more that opened up. Right now, he says, downtown Fresno is big in brewery. There are like six breweries downtown. What else needs to go down there besides breweries to make this place a draw, because not everybody drinks beer?
Yeah, and so I think there needs to be, you know, well, there needs to be a lot of amenities. We do have a small pocket park now that just was opened in December. So we need lots of things. We need a grocery store. We have a pharmacy. We need upgraded, you know, pharmacy. We need a lot of things other than just breweries. But when you see Bitwise come in, and you see other businesses. It's funny you mentioned Aaron Blair. It's funny you mentioned Aaron Blair. Yesterday in the late afternoon, I introduced him to a billionaire from India who's interested in buying another building.
A billionaire?
Yeah.
From India?
Yes.
That wants to buy a building in downtown Fresno?
Yes, exactly.
To do what with it?
Well, this guy has a concept of a school, and so a tech school. So we're going to, yeah.
All right. Caller, go ahead. You're on with Steve Brandow.
I don't disagree. I do disagree that turning it into a street is not going to help the business there, because the fact that the city of Fresno has always, I mean, they don't want to let go of those darn parking meters that prohibit people from coming downtown. You know, I mean, nobody wants to pay for their parking. They just want to park and do some shopping, you know. And I think that if you would take out those parking meters and allow people to park in front of stores so they can do their shopping and add revenue to the city, I think that would help incredibly, because you know, I mean, there aren't enough parking, the buildings, you know, by Tuchansky Park and so forth, or by Radisson, that, you know, to fill it. So, I mean, I think it's, no matter how you put it, no matter what you do, it's gonna take away from being able to access those buildings and so forth, because people don't, you just keep driving them north where there are no meters.
All right.
Yeah.
And what about the parking
meters?
Well,
we just had this battle two weeks ago, right?
I know.
And unfortunately, council moved the opposite direction of what your caller suggested. And I voted no. I was more in line with what your caller's suggesting. I wasn't at the point where I said, let's just get rid of all of the parking meters. But I certainly didn't think it was a good time to raise the rates. Okay.
Right.
I didn't think, back to your story, there's not enough down there to incentivize people to come down there if you're going to charge them, especially raise the rates. So I made the complaint, the argument that it's a bad time to raise the rates, but my colleagues saw it the other way, and we raised rates. And so, fortunately, I did not vote on
and
that.
They're up close to what? Yeah. Is it like $1.75 an hour now?
Yeah, it's at some of the preferred stalls, $1.75 an hour. I will say so that your caller knows, one of our biggest problems is the city of Fresno owns the parking structures, and they're upside down. We owe more on them than what they're worth. So it makes a lot of misery.
We got 3 minutes. I want two more quick questions.
Sure.
Terrence Frazier wants to revitalize Granite Park. He's got this big building he wants to put out there not in the outfield, but beyond the center field wall at Tuchansky Park. Now he wants to open up a bowling alley too. He's a very, I guess, motivated developer. Do you see him as an asset in Fresno?
I see him as a great asset. And one of the reasons...
Is he trying to do too much?
You know, I'd have to leave that up to Terrence. That guy's an energetic go-getter, right? And another level that I appreciate about Terrence Frazier, he's got a heart. It began with wanting to reach out to these kids and give them things to do in the afternoon. So he's a great guy. I don't know exactly what he has planned for Granite Park, but I'm all ears because...
Do you have to be careful that he doesn't get the city underwater in some of these projects and get the city involved with city money?
Yeah, and so far the city, we're a lot, you know, it seems like we're sharper than we used to be on these issues because we are not putting the taxpayers of the city of Fresno at risk like was done previously.
Just because he wants to build these projects, don't put us at risk, the taxpayer.
Now, we might help him with some benefit, some cost benefit, or help him find some mechanism that makes it pencil out, but it's not the same as putting our money on the line. Okay,
one more quick question. I think that's all we have time for. That $6,500 fee for the water hookup, is that to pay for the new surface water treatment plant in Southeast Fresno?
No.
Email question.
Yeah, the answer is no. No.
It's no.
Completely separate.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, I'd like you to come back at some point.
Yeah, we worked through a lot of stuff today.
Yeah, we did, and I appreciate your honesty.
Great callers.
And, aren't they? They're well-informed viewers.
Yeah, both sides.
I know.
Yeah.
They're very well-informed, and so I appreciate all the phone calls from you. Steve, appreciate your time.
John, thank you.
I'll see you down the line, I hope.
Yes, you will.
Okay. Steve Brandow, City Councilman, District Number 2. Make it out to the council meeting tomorrow if you can. They got one. It starts at what time?
8:30 in the morning.
All righty. See you back here tomorrow on Connect With Me on MeTV Fresno. And we'll talk Clovis Unified School District.
If you have a need to promote your business or event, please consider MeTV Fresno for your next campaign. MeTV reaches over 100,000 of your potential customers in the Fresno area every single week. Plus, you can rest assured that your commercial is running in the greatest family-friendly programs of all time. MeTV Fresno delivers a strong, loyal audience ready to buy, and your campaign will cost a fraction of what you're paying for your advertising now. Call me today to find out how affordable MeTV is at 905-1925.
Giddy up with Westerns. We've got the best ones. Superhero sci-fi Sven. Grab the popcorn and stay in. Drama's mystery and action. Take a look and see what happens. Carol, Andy, Lucy, MASH. Timeless comedies full of laughs.
Hey, that's me.
That's me.
That's me, Chief.
Yeah, me, me, me.
Me, me, me. You gotta see. That's memorable. That's me.
Me.
Me TV.
The Ballad of Andy and Barney. Andy and Barney were lawmen, bravest you ever did see. Warned every crook in the record book to stay out.